much of the Leviticus chapter 16 that I'll speak of, but I'll try to speak enough that I think that that you'll be able to equate what I'm saying with it. But we're about to finish the year, the Torah lessons. So I asked the question, how would we summarize this year? And I think how I would summarize this year is whatever the Lord has said, He said not only to Israel, but He said to us as well. The great lessons of Torah are for all men now. They're not just historical, but they're applicable in our life today. And for the New Covenant believer, there should be no doubt in this. In that God presents to us in His entire Word the call to holiness. That's how I would summarize this last year's Torah lessons, is that God calls all men throughout the world to holiness, which to Him and therefore must be to us a full consecration of soul and body to the Lord. That is, that there must be a determined separation from all that which defiles, and then in turn with that separation, determination, there should be an embracing of all that is becoming Christ-like in nature, with the hope of attaining unto the promised kingdom inheritance. And of course, the only way of attainment being through the personal drawing nigh through the atonement and the mediation of the appointed high priest with the evidence of bearing fruit acceptable unto Him. Just a paragraph to summarize what I believe that the Torah lessons of this last year should have spoken to us, and hopefully that's the part that resonates in us for the remainder of our lives. And again, today's the Day of Atonement, so I decided to bring forth a lesson on the Day of Atonement. I went to pull some of the past, I don't know how many years, a lot of years of teaching on the Day of Atonement. I think I've taught on it from every perspective known to man. So I went to pull those, and I didn't. I didn't pull them, neither on the computer or any of the hard copies that go way back, tapes, cassette tapes, and etc. I just asked the Lord. I sat quiet meditation, asking the Lord what He would like me to speak on, and I often do this. I often, in my heart, listen, and then I say, "Well, Lord, there's nothing very fresh or new in that. I really want something fresh and new. You know, I'm always about new and fresh." And I just had the thought, well, you know, what's not new and fresh to me might be new and fresh to someone else. It wouldn't hurt anything to speak in terms of truth as it relates to the Day of Atonement. And I'm not sure that I have captured all of those truths, because I've stopped as I came to some established truths, at least in my heart and mind, and meditated on them individually. I didn't try to continue thinking about one truth after another. I simply just took the ones that came to my heart readily, and then I allowed them to roll over in me, and then I wrote these things down in these four of my pages, which again, I would keep shortening them in hopes of having a reasonable amount of time. So I'm going to bring them forth to you. I don't know exactly when I should reference the drawing or the illustration. I made this morning very readily, as I generally do. If I had much time, I usually scribble in my illustrations on a notebook, and then I have Patty put them on a board, because she does such a much better job Again, I would that I was as talented as Jim is in the artistic skills, and more than just his artistic skills, but certainly he has some fine artistic skills. But you'll have to try to just work with me on what I've drawn up there. And I don't know exactly when that I'll get to them. I don't know if I should start off with them or if I should just on the way. Maybe I'll start off with this board and explain it. And then as we read the lesson, maybe I'll reference back to this board just a little bit. I didn't want to put on too much. There is a lot that I could put on a board with this heading, the two parts of the atonement, the two parts of the atonement of the Messiah. There's a myriad of lists on the left and on the right under the two parts that could be written out. And I have at different times expounded on this a great deal. I don't know so much here in the United States, but this is really a relevant teaching when you go overseas, where those denominationalized Christians that I come into have no understanding or revelation as it relates to the two parts of the atonement. They just have heard the one part, that of redemption, and that's basically all. But on this Day of Atonement, I thought that I needed to expound on atonement, also about what is the Day of Atonement and what is the Day of the Lord and how these two relate and are interconnected with some other events that will happen on that the Day of Atonement. And so we'll speak about those things. But before we do that, I think that we should speak in terms of how that Yeshua, Christ, fulfilled Leviticus chapter 16. Because this is exactly what the Messiah did. This is what Yeshua did. That all the meanings that are typed in chapter 16 of Leviticus are filled with their perfect meaning in the Messiah. And most of you have read the ritual. It's fairly extensive and thorough dealings with the transgressions, with the sins of Israel. So this board represents that which Yeshua fulfilled in the atonement for the transgressions of men. And that this drawing, if it was done correctly, would kind of play like a video, in that we'd focus in and we'd see the Messiah Yeshua in heaven in all of his regalia as the only begotten Son of God, the consort of God. We'd see him. That's how we'd focus in on it. And then the next thing we would see is Christ emptying himself and coming to the earth and then becoming the Son of Man through the virgin birth of Mary. Then we would follow him through his years of ministry until the cross. And then we'd pick up again with him after a few days on the resurrection. And then we'd pick up with him a few days later, 40 plus, at his coronation, at the day of Pentecost and the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. And then we would be now waiting in that transition as he is now the resurrected high priest of our confession, sitting at the right hand of the Father, awaiting until he is sent to the earth. So that's kind of the chronological order of what we would see in the Messiah's atonement. And that has to do or deals with us, you and I, has to do with what I have always alluded to as the minor grace. It's not to take away from anything of its significance, but it yet is the minor grace in that which the blood, the Passover blood, deals with, which is the death, the cross, and the death of Jesus Christ, and how that relates to sin. And somebody might read one Psalms 103. You know the scripture in that the Lord will separate us from our sin as far as the east from the west. So that scripture, I put that in context of the very first part of the atonement of the Messiah that he came to fulfill by his death, in that he was found to have no sin in him, and he was unjustly slain, innocent Lamb of God, and on the cross and the pouring out of the blood, we find in that the redemption of sin. And in that side of the gospel, most everyone throughout the world who has heard the gospel relates to it and understands. But there is another part that's a part of the atonement of the Messiah, and that has to do with his coronation, with his resurrection. So we could see Christ unclothed, come out from the temple of God, become the Son of Man, pay the penalty for sin, go to the grave. And in the grave, we understand he spent 3 days in the grave. And then he was resurrected out from among the dead, set back at the right hand of the Father. He became King of Kings. He was crowned King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And he led captivity captive in that he led his enemies into heaven in solemn procession, in joyous procession, through the streets of heaven, triumphing over them in his victory. So in that coronation, in that celebration, in that fulfilling of what God had said, not only in that your propitiation price is enveloped in this, but the propitiation price to settle man's fall is also in this. So it's a combination of both of these things, the pouring out of his blood, but the pouring out of his soul, and that he withstood within the belly of the earth, also was a part of that atonement. And it was this part that actually brought about the outpouring, the promise of the Holy Spirit, John chapter 7, 37 through 39, where it says that the promise of the Holy Spirit would come after this death, resurrection, coronation. So this is the minor grace. And then after the coronation on the day of Pentecost, we have the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, which I call the major grace, which is the power of the gift of the Holy Spirit. This is the big, significant difference between the Old Covenant and the New Covenant. It has to do with efficacy. It has to do with propitiation. And so therefore, you and I are the recipients of, after having received the sin offering, we now are able to draw upon this greater major grace, the outpouring of the gift of the power of the Holy Spirit, unto Christ's likeness. So what we have over here is the blood that's represented in the Passover, and what we have on this side after the outpouring of the Holy Spirit is that's represented in the Pentecost, and it has the resurrection power associated with it that is reflective upon our sin nature, that we draw the power through the greater grace to apply to the character of our being, that rogue character that God left within us. So when you approach many people on the evangelistic side of the atonement, you approach them on this, And you say, you need this part of the atonement of the Messiah. For you, you need eternal life. You need to receive the redemption that's been paid for by the blood of Yeshua. And all those things are true when you speak them. And they're received and people are born again. And their spirits are renewed. But very little is known about the other part of the atonement of the Messiah, which reflects the greater grace. There are some that are aware of this and have been throughout the decades, but to the greatest of degree, this side of the atonement of the Messiah has either been leavened out entirely, or the power of it has been misassociated with the gifts and different applications that have taken away the very center heart focus of what God had intended, which was the reestablishing of His kingdom within our nature. So you see how it's gotten off. The devil's used his sly, clever, subtle manipulations to obscure this side of the message. And so when we speak today of the Day of Atonement, we need to understand that the atonement of Leviticus chapter 16 has been fulfilled by the Messiah. And that we need to understand that the dynamics that were involved in the Leviticus 16 had to do with these two parts. In that we can see it down through all the offerings, but especially in the Day of Atonement, we have that burnt sin offering. But we realize that in the offerings, other than on the Day of Atonement, we realize that there are other offerings, but those other offerings have to do with a voluntary sacrifice. Whereas on the burnt sin offering and the trespass offering, they're compulsory. They're compulsory. You have to do these things if you want to draw nigh to God. If you have sin in your life, if you sin, then you must bring forth this sin offering. And you, if you trespass against your brother, you must bring forth this sin offering. It's compulsory. But on the other side, that's reflected in the resurrection power side and the sin nature side, which is the whole burnt offering, the meal offering, and the peace offerings, these are voluntary. They're voluntary in the Levitical Mosaic ritual. So this voluntary speaks to you and my will. It speaks to our understanding of our desire to draw nigh unto God. And so therefore we're willing to wholeheartedly bring before God an offering voluntarily, which has to do with the recreating of a nature within us, or not recreating it, but bring it in into dominion. And allowing a new nature to be brought in. And this is why it is a sweet savor. Those offerings are mentioned in the Levitical ministry, in the priesthood, as those things, those offerings that are a sweet savor unto God. Whereas these compulsory burnt offerings, sin burnt offerings, they're not a sweet savor unto God. Why? Because they're compulsory. But wherever they are voluntary, then they're a sweet savor unto God. So under the minor grace, there is this offering that God honors, that His mercy has dictated, and that He has wrought for our well-being, our eternal well-being. But in this grace is not near the power that was afforded in the other part of the atonement of the Messiah, which has to do with His resurrection, of His time in the grave, His resurrection, and then His coronation. So, is that kind of making any sense? Well, there's another note that I made myself in that I would bring out, is that you're all probably aware of the two goat process called the scapegoat process of Leviticus chapter 16, where the two goats are brought, identical goats, and then lots are drawn and put upon each goat. And one is for Azazel, and the other is for the Lord. And one's hands are laid on, and then it's turned out into the wilderness and set free. The other is sacrificed, and its blood is taken into the holiest place and offered. And in the first goat, that which comes in before the Lord, and the blood is sprinkled before the Lord, this first goat represents the means, redemption. It's the means. It's redemption's means. So there must be the shedding of the blood before there's redemption. So the first goat represents this side of the atonement of the Messiah, his death and his blood. That's the means. But the redemption means has a purpose. And redemption's purpose is the reconciliation unto God. So the purpose in the second goat, reflective in the second goat, or the typing of the second goat, is the effect. So you over in the first goat you have the means, but in the second goat you have the effect, or the means for the purpose to bring about reconciliation and sonship. Over here we're a child of God. Over here we're esteemed sons of God. I think it would be good if you could meditate on the means and meditate on the effect. Because it's on the means that we are drawing that we might apply the effect unto sonship through the major grace. And then just keeping in theme with all the last however many lessons over the last year or so, I've written down the obvious in that over underneath the Passover blood and the minor grace is the gift of eternal life. And then over and above the other part of the gospel, the second part of the gospel, the first part having to do with the gift, the second part of the gospel having to do with the prize being the first resurrection, the sonship, the anointings and the giftings of authority to rule and reign with Christ in his millennial period, and then that of those benefits that have to do with having been a part of the first resurrection, such as a name that no man knows, and the second death having no place in you, etc. So that's the drawing that might help to illustrate, might even make this lesson make a lot more sense with that up there. Feel free to ask me any question anytime. So here we are, the Day of Atonement, Yom Kippur. It is the holiest day of the year for the Jewish people, as Jerry said. Its biblical themes are atonement for sin and repentance. The day is observed by the Jew with fasting and prayer, abstaining from physical pleasures, and refraining from work. And as it is also taught by the rabbis that on this day the fate of each person is sealed for the upcoming year. I know there's some of that teaching that has filtered down to the children, because one of the little cards that one of the children drew me last week was, "May your name be sealed in heaven." So I said, I know where they got that. So that is one of the rabbinical teachings, is that I find that nowhere in the scripture, at least not in a clear definitional way. I do see some things that I can relate to, though, in that I might speak about later. So although it is entirely Jewish in its observance, its historical meanings and present-day significance are universal. I think that's significant to say to you that we should understand that it's entirely a Jewish observance. It's not one for the New Covenant believer to observe. Not that I'm speaking against anybody observing in the sense of having a revelation knowledge of what they're doing, as opposed to thinking that somehow we are to blend in Yom Kippur into our New Covenant believing. It is significant, it is historically important, and it does have some relevance to today, but as a rule, it's a Jewish holiday or a Jewish observance as a part of the last day of the Feast of Trumpets. So what we should understand about the Day of Atonement historically and how it relates to Christians today, that's generally what I'm going to try to speak to. First in meaningfulness. I mean, the first thing that you can think of is that it is timeless declaration of the absolute need for the atonement of sin in order to draw nigh unto God. That's, if you wonder, what is the meaningfulness of the Day of Atonement? That's the significance. That's the meaningfulness. And that transcends all denominations and everybody on the whole earth is subject to that understanding, whether they know it or not. That's the reality of the Day of Atonement. There is sin, and there must be atonement in order that a man may draw nigh unto God. So again, I reference you to this illustration. Christ has fulfilled. God has, through His Son, Yeshua, Jesus the Christ, filled this Day of Atonement up with meaning. He's filled the day up with meaning. He's fulfilled the Day of Atonement. So glory to Him. Glory to Him. We should elevate our thinking way above any kind of ritualistic kind of observance of the Day of Atonement. And we should esteem Him who has filled that day up with meaning. Praise God. Praise the Lord Jesus Christ for the atonement. So the Jewish people's attempt to observe this ancient commands of Moses through observances instituted by the rabbis since the destruction of the temple and its service are not applicable for the appropriating of that atonement. They're not applicable for the appropriating of that atonement. What atonement? The atonement of the Mosaic Law in Leviticus chapter 16. I'm not saying that I completely discount the significance of the Jewish's contrite, humble heart on the Day of Atonement, nor their desire to do good and to pray and to fast. I'm not in any way demeaning that and calling that without any importance or without any significance to God. I'm not saying that at all. I'm simply saying that has been put forth in Leviticus chapter 16 for the atonement of the individual and the nation of Israel is no longer appropriated through those means. Why? Because the temple and the priest service has been done away with. The temple's been destroyed and there's no longer any priesthood. And it was the high priest only that could officiate on this Day of Atonement. So you can see, whatever they might have today is so far, far, far inferior to what was there in place in Leviticus chapter 16. But still, I have no problem with fasting on this day and praying on this day. Not in the sense of atonement, but in the sense of soliciting, petitioning the Lord my God for the help of not only the Jewish nations, but the Gentiles who are in darkness in this world. I have no problem with that. If you're going to declare a fast for praying for other people, I think a Day of Atonement would be a fine day to do it. But again, you need to know what you're doing when you do it, because it's unacceptable to God for us to take a posture as if we're doing the Levitical 16 kind of Mosaic commandments, you know? That we should be beyond that. We should have more maturity than that. We should understand. And what we shouldn't demean what they do today. They do what they have to do today. They have no choice to do anything else. It isn't like they can go and present in accordance with Mosaic law. Does that make any sense to you? Hopefully it'll clarify some small little points in your own thinking. The Messiah, that is to say the Savior, the sin covering for the Jewish people, has been sent. He was sent, he has been sent, and he was rejected. And so therefore their house has been left desolate according to the Lord. This is the word of the Lord. He said, O Jerusalem, Jerusalem, thou that killest the prophets and stonest them with which are sent unto thee, how often would I have gathered thy children together, even as a hen gathereth her chickens under her wings, and you would not. Behold, your house is left unto you desolate. For I say unto you, you shall not see me henceforth till you shall say, blessed is he that cometh in the name of the Lord. Matthew 23:37-39. So, Isaiah speaks in terms of, you remember the scripture where the Lord stood up and he spoke and he opened the word to Isaiah and he said, the anointing of the Lord is upon me. That was on the Day of Atonement. That was a representing a Day of Atonement. But it's also, he stopped, you remember, in mid-sentence and said, where it went into the vengeance of the Lord. So what we're going to understand and speak of a little bit more thorough is how that the atonement of the Lord has been, how that Day of the Atonement has been filled up with meaning in the Messiah on both that redemptive side and on the vengeance side. And then secondly, that was first in meaningfulness is, but secondly, Christians should understand that the Day of Atonement and the Great Day of the Lord are interconnected as they are the same shadowing of the future Day of the Return. Okay? I don't think y'all were with me on that, so I'm going to say it again. You and I should, as Christians, should secondarily, after understanding the meaningfulness of the absolute need for the atonement of sin in order to draw nigh to God, the second thing that Christians should understand is that the Day of the Atonement and the Great Day of the Lord in Scripture are interconnected as they are the same shadowing of the future day of His return. Okay? And then, interconnected into that, is the sabbatical seventh year and the Day of Jubilee. They are types for the future seventh day millennial Sabbath day of rest and are interconnected scripturally as a part of the Day of Atonement, Day of the Lord. Are you kind of with me on that? You want me to draw that? I would draw that. Yeah. I would draw that. Kind of. See, how would I draw that? All right. Okay, here's a line, right? And that's time. So here, okay, here's the garden. Here's the coming of the Lord the first time. And here's the coming of the Lord the second time. In the coming of the Lord the second time, this is the Day of the Lord. Day of Atonement. The seventh year or sabbatical year, what does that mean? That means every 7 years, right? Every 7 years is a sabbatical year and the ground lays fallow, right? Okay, and then you count seven sevens, and that's a year of Jubilee, right? That's the 49th year, seven sevens. So in addition to that seventh year in that the ground would lay fallow, then also in the eighth day or the 50th year, which is also representative of the eighth day because it's the one after the seventh, then in that year, the 50th year is called the year of Jubilee. So not only does the land lay fallow, but all slaves are turned free. All debts are forgiven. So not only is this the day of the Lord, the day of atonement, the seventh year of salvation, sabbatical year, but it's also the 50th. In other words, it's the seven sevens, right? So it is the day of Jubilee. Now this is on the Lord's calendar, right? I have no idea on our calendar, the Jewish calendar, or any other calendar, but I'm just saying, spiritually speaking, the return of the Lord will fulfill all of these on that one day. Now, are you kind of with me? Now, yes, Jim.
In legal terms, if you have a future interest, the Day of Atonement coming, future, you cannot have it, it won't transfer or convey unless you have a present interest. So the first one, the goat that was slain.
First goat that was slain.
Right.
It's
your enjoyment.
Yeah, your enjoyment.
You don't have anything in the future if you don't enjoy it today.
That's right.
It can't happen.
It's not, if you don't have a part. You
can't buy the house or whatever the thing is.
Right.
So if you have the present enjoyment now, but you forget the future because you're just completely satisfied, as you're pointing out, that the church is done. Forget the future. I mean, there is kind of a vague future, but you're not really enjoying power, majesty, glory in the present. And that present is real, but it's not as great as. It's not as glorious as. So at all times, by having all those sevens and 50s and so on, he is reminding us forever, never forget that the present is wonderful, but it's nothing compared to.
Yes.
So you have the real thing, but it's only a portion, only a part. And it's not the full. And that's what's wrong today.
Amen. We have the means, but we need to look to the future for the purpose, which has an effect on us. The second goat is the effect. It's the thing that we should be concentrating on. Just to add credibility, not credibility, but to underline what Jim just said, we have to have this to have a part in this. But to have a part in this does not guarantee a part in that. So we're all together in that these four things are interconnected, and they are all one and the same day. And then these two things, the seventh year of the sabbatical year, in other words, or the 50th, the day of Jubilee, these point to the millennial seventh day rest. The millennial seventh day rest, right? The millennial seventh day being 1,000, right? So that's the seventh day. It's the seventh 1,000-year period or age. We're in the sixth right now, at the end of the sixth. So the seventh day period is the millennial rest or the kingdom of heaven, the kingdom of Christ. So this ushers in this. This, on this day, ushers in this. Okay. So seen as in succession of the trumpet blasts. And what I mean by that, seen in succession of trumpet blasts, I mean we have had 10 days of sounding of the trumpets, have we not? This is are the days of awe from the first of the year, Rosh Hashanah to today. We've had the succession of trumpets, trumpet playing. But there is a reference to the last trump, the last trumpet. And this succession of trumpet blasts, the last would be that one which sounds at the reappearing of the high priest from that holy place upon the final act of atonement. So if you'll remember, the high priest goes in to the holiest of places, and then he stays in there. He goes in alone. He's the only one in the tabernacle, and they wait. And when he comes out, that is when that final trumpet blasts. The final. That's it. That's the final trumpet. Well, what that final trumpet blast does in a normal year would mean that the transgressions of Israel have been covered. They have been atoned for. But in this particular day of the Lord, the atonement day, the seventh sabbatical year, the Jubilee year, then that blast, that final trump, also represents Jubilee, the seventh day, the millennial rest, the kingdom of Christ. That's what that final trumpet blast means. Hallelujah. Okay. The high priest then puts on his awesome regalia and he comes forth. Having made atonement for all the transgressions, the trumpet now sounds for the commencement of the year of Jubilee, that which types Jubilee. All these years, as Jim was saying, the Lord is always wanting you to look forward. All of those looking forwards are leading to a place, and that place is the great day of the Lord, which is the culminating, the pinnacle of reconciliation, the resurrection from among the dead, and the millennial kingdom commencement. I try to keep this simple. I think you all are following me, aren't you? Okay. Significance also is the understanding that all things determined for the sabbatical year and Jubilee follow the expiation of sin. It's significant that we should understand that all of these things find their beginning or their genesis after the remission of sins, after the expiation of sin. We should keep that in mind, that this day of atonement of the Lord, this great day of the Lord, is also dealing with sin. It has to be a day of dealing with sin, so that then, after the expiation of that sin, now can come reconciliation. Now can we call for the rapture from the four corners of all the Jewish people. Now we can set in place and begin this millennial period, because there has been reparation, there has been forgiveness, and there has been all transgressions have been covered. You with me? Okay. The instruction to Israel, and no less to us, is that sabbatical year and the year of Jubilee date from the Day of Atonement. And then thirdly, Christians should understand that the end time significance of the Feast of Trumpets is the proclamation of those days leading up to that final Day of Atonement in the near future. We should understand that we are about to experience these things. And that when we observe, when we take note of these feasts of the Lord, that we are aware of what is coming onto the earth. That we should see our redemption drawing nigh, and these things should become alive into us. They should have a staying power. They should have a purifying power. As we look up, beholding for the Lord is coming, that should be purifying us and making us ready. These are the end times when soon the full consummation of the age will take place. We understand that this period of time is an age. This is an age. The Lord refers to this as an age. I'm sorry. I forgot where I drew my lines. This is an age, which is that from the death of the Messiah until the return of the Messiah, this is this age that we now live in. So we're fast approaching the end of our age. Then this final age is the seventh day rest, the thousandth millennium. So we're in this age, which is 2,000 years long, to the final 1,000 year age before the eighth day. Not too complicated, is it? Try to keep it where we can understand and follow this, because we're trying to understand this, the atonement of the Messiah. These are the end times when soon the full consummation of the age will take place, and then the kingdom of heaven is at hand. So that last age is the kingdom of heaven, the kingdom of the Messiah, the kingdom, the millennial kingdom of the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. That seventh day. So the kingdom, that kingdom is at hand. That is to say, when the gospel of the kingdom of heaven has been preached in all the world for witness unto all nations, and then shall the end come. Matthew 24:14. Matthew 24:14 was the Lord when he was responding to the disciples and they were asking him, when will we see the end? When shall all these things come to pass? And the Lord speaks in terms of he will return when the gospel of the kingdom of heaven has been preached in all the world for a witness unto all nations, and then shall the end come. There are many trumpet sounds in the world today, but only the clear note of the proclamation of Matthew 13:11, where it says, the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven moves the clock of end times. You might wonder, what is he saying there? Because it's not very clear. I'm simply saying that the gospel of the kingdom of heaven is a mystery. It's what Christ called it. He called it a mystery. To us who have heard the first part of the atonement of the Messiah, there's no mysteries. We know everything. There's nothing left for us to know. We have heard the mystery of the kingdom of heaven in this, that we've heard that Jesus Christ died for us. Wrong. The mystery of the kingdom of heaven is the entire message that's brought about in the two parts of the gospel, the two parts of the atonement of Christ. It is this part that Israel rejected when Christ tried to have them receive the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven. Matthew 13 says that he had then blinded them, that they would not be able to see the realities of the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven, and that he turned to another people. He turned to the Gentiles in order to share the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven. And it is this, that mysteries of the kingdom of heaven message, that must be taken throughout the world as a witness against the nations. He is not speaking in terms of just this message being that mysterious message of the gospel that is a witness to all the peoples on the earth. It's the fullness of the message that Christ speaks of. And it's that then that moves the clock. If that makes any sense to you. What I'm trying to say is, in the last days, God's going to pour out the truth, where it's going to be such a witness and such a testimony against the nations. It's not going to be obscured like it is now, where we can hardly understand any of the mysteries of the kingdom of heaven. us being, even though we have still much to learn, we are so much further ahead than the general Christian is, who has no understanding whatsoever of the mysteries of the kingdom of Christ. It's this message that will be brought out toward the end time in clarity as a witness against the nations. You rejected me. You rejected my kingdom. You may have received the gospel, but you rejected the kingdom. It's the same thing as the Jews did. They received the blood, but they refused the prize. They received the gift, but they refused the prize. The day of the Lord and the day of the atonement, does this day not represent a day of reckoning and a day, also a day of expiation of sin? What we're talking about is the Day of Atonement and how it's applicable to us as Christians today. And I ask the question, isn't that Day of the Lord, the Day of Atonement, isn't this both a day of reckoning? Isn't it a day of reckoning as well? What do I mean by that? Well, isn't the Lord going to reckon with us? Isn't He going to reckon with us? That it is not on this level that He reckons with us, but He is reckoning on this level. He does reckon on this level with those over here, as Jim said, that never had a part. He reckons with them as well. But He is reckoning on this day of the Lord, as well as this having a day of expiation of sin. Why do I say it's a day of expiation of sin? Because there is a expiation of sin that is promoted and advanced toward the nation of Israel. When they see Him and they mourn, then they turn unto Him. So this is dealing with the transgression of sin. It is dealing with the expiation of sin. So He comes in this day of the Lord in that high priest expiation of sin dress, but He also comes in a form of a reckoning for those that are His subjects. He also comes as to dole out the merit to those that have rejected Him as King. So it's not just, the Day of Atonement is not just about the expiation of sin, but it's also about the day of reckoning. We as Christians should understand that this is the day of reckoning. That day is not just about the Jews, that day is about me. He's going to reckon with me that day. I'm going to know my fate. My fate for what? I'm going to know whether I have a part in the kingdom of heaven. I'm going to know if I have a millennial part with Christ. Am I going to rule and reign with Him or not? Because I have this does not necessarily mean that I will gain unto this.
One thing that's really helped me on what all you've been saying is, it's like as a Christian, when I got saved, I just went at it with an axe. I mean, I just started doing everything I possibly could, but I didn't really know how God laid it out. So when we were going back through earlier, it said one of the unclean things. It said he's gonna cleanse himself on the third day and on the seventh day. And when I saw that, I said, "Wow, Lord, in all this Old Testament stuff, you can see God's progression. If you don't have that, you can't rest where you're at. Because He's not going to do certain things right now. And if you're trying for that, you're going to be frustrated." And I have been frustrated because I'm reaching for too much.
Yeah.
And so I'm starting to see, okay, Lord, just for now, whatever you're doing now, that's what I need to see and hear and enter into that. Yeah. Otherwise, I can't enter into a rest. I'm unclear about where I should be.
Yeah.
And so it's always, there's no rest or peace in it.
Yeah.
So it's very helpful, I think. Very, very. And so I'm starting to say, okay, God, What's for now? What's for just now? Not too much, but what right now?
Yeah. What should I be applying to myself right now?
Yeah. Because some of it's not going to happen until the millennium. I don't care what you do. You're not going to get ahead of what God's
going to
do.
No. And you references to the cleansing of the leper on the third and the seventh day, and we spoke about that in terms of this.
Yeah, so the third day is Jesus' work, and the seventh day is the millennium. So
yeah.
There's going to be another cleansing that whole 1,000 years somehow.
Yeah. Yeah, that's an exciting story, and the impact of it is affecting you in the same way it's affecting me. And it's incentivizing me to be in what I'm in, be where I'm at, and do what I'm doing. I know that I'm not glorified. I know that I have some leprosy within me. I know that I'm still not declared clean and that I can enter into the Holy of Holies. But I'm not no longer outside the camp. I'm in the camp, and I'm awaiting the seventh day outside my tent for the leper's cleansing. That's what I'm waiting for. I know where you're contrite in that condition, but you're anticipating in that condition as well. And you're grateful in that condition because you're no longer outside. They're full of leprosy. It's incentivizing to me. I don't look at myself in the same way. I don't look at him in the same way. I look forward to what he's going to do in me if I will stay outside my tent and not presume to be able to do that or presume that I now can do this. But here I am, and this is where I'm supposed to be, and that's what I'm supposed to do. Patty? No one? Somebody, I thought, raised their hand. So, this day of reckoning and the day of expiation of sin are two different roles that the Lord will fulfill on that day. He fulfills several roles. I can think of three or four, just bang, bang, bang. And these are two of them. And then he fulfills the role of king, another one. And then what was the other one that went through my mind? No mind. It's just to know this, that on this day, the Day of Atonement, the Day of the Lord fulfills a lot of functions on that day. And it has to do with every man living and dead. Every man. This day has reference to every human being that ever was. This day. It's a significant day. It's what we call it, the great day of the Lord. It's soon, too. It's not far. It's not far. It's not long. Or none of the things we believe in are true. The whole house of cards comes falling down. But the reality is that it is true, and we have the witness in our heart. All people, dead and alive, Jews, Gentiles, and the new creation have a part in its soon coming manifestation. For Israel, a great day of distress and affliction of the soul in all Israel, to the putting away completely of all sin. And then for the heathen, Gentile, a fearful and dreadful day of reckoning. And then for the new creature, a good reckoning resulting in reconciliation of the glorious kind. So we see there the Lord fulfills a lot of functions or a lot of different roles on this day. The prophetic and suspended, just as the seventh day, seventh week of the 70 weeks of Daniel is suspended, so is this final day of atonement. Suspended, the final day of fulfilling of the atonement. The last day of atonement was somewhere around 70 AD. Well, since then it's been suspended. There will be another final, complete day of atonement. And all the Bible speaks of it. And then at the shout of that archangel and the heavenly trumpet blast, Christ will return. And having poured out his vengeance upon Israel and the Gentile nations, in that the blood will run bridle deep, the Bible says, Israel will recognize him finally as Messiah and mourn. He then will fulfill numerous scriptures of prophecy, of which Isaiah 11:11 stands out to me. And it says, "And it shall come to pass in that day that the Lord shall set his hand again the second time to recover the remnant of his people, which shall be left from Assyria and from Egypt and from the islands of the sea." A scripture that foresees the tremendous scattering and persecution just prior to the Atonement Day. Then we have Zechariah 12:10, which most of you are familiar with that scripture, but I'm going to read it real quickly. Zechariah 12:10. It says, "And I will pour upon the house of David and upon the inhabitants of Jerusalem the spirit of grace and of supplications, and they shall look upon me whom they have pierced, and they shall mourn for him as one mourneth for his only son, and shall be in bitterness for him as one that is in bitterness for his firstborn." Have you wondered when that would be? Well, if you have wondered, wonder no longer. It's on the Day of Atonement. It's on the day, the great day of the Lord. It's on the second coming of Christ that they, Israel, shall experience the fulfilling of that scripture right there. And then also Zechariah 13:1. "In that day there shall be a fountain opened to the house of David and to the inhabitants of Jerusalem for sin and for uncleanliness." That fountain being the outpouring of the Holy Spirit. So those events precedes that which will surely follow, the great gathering of the Jews from the four corners of the earth back to the land. Christ himself said that. The fulfillment of Romans 11:12-15, their fullness, life from the dead. Do you know what I'm speaking of when I say Romans 11? You should know that that will be fulfilled at this same time. Romans 11:12. "Now if the fall of them be the riches of the world, and the diminishing of them the riches of the Gentiles, how much more their fullness?" Their fullness is the Jews' reconciliation. Their fullness comes when? Here, on the Day of Atonement. Their fullness, that last day of atonement. And then the other scripture that has reference to the same time is the 15th verse. "For if the casting away of them," the Jews, "be the reconciling of the world," and that's how we came in, isn't it? "What shall the receiving of them be but life from the dead?" So it speaks in terms of both the resurrection of the dead, the faithful Jewish dead, and it speaks in terms of the faithful that are living in that they will be made alive. So those also are events that will happen and be fulfilled in the house of Israel on that great day. But not only here is there a great gathering of Jews on that day as a result of that day, but spoken of also by the prophets. But the New Covenant apostles as well speak of and refer to this future Day of Atonement, which is the restoration of all things. Are you familiar with that? Acts 3:17, it says, "And now, brethren, I would that through ignorance you did it, as did also your rulers. But those things which God before had showed by the mouth of all his prophets, that Christ should suffer, he hath so fulfilled. Repent ye therefore, and be converted, that your sins may be blotted out, when the times of refreshing shall come from the presence of the Lord. And he shall send Christ Jesus, which before was preached unto you, when the heaven must receive until whom the heaven must receive until the times of restitution of all things, which God has spoken by the mouth of all His holy prophets since the world began. So there is this gathering up of the Jews, but there's at this Day of Atonement, but there's also at this Day of Atonement that which is referenced to by Peter here in Acts of the restoration of all things. It is in this future Day of Atonement wherein those holy type septenaries are fully realized in that which follows. So that those sevens all consummating together, finally, they have a significance in meaning. Then they're fully realized in after the Day of Atonement, where the resurrection out from among the dead, that reckoning, then in gathering of all the Jews from around the world, and the institution of the foreshadowed tabernacles. We understand that, don't we? I feel as if I have to spend time on all these details, but we understand that this time frame that is the seventh day millennial rest is also that time frame that's typed in the Feast of Tabernacles. So this, after the Day of the Lord, in the completion of the restoration of all things that Peter refers to in Acts chapter 3, together, all these all things are not only the restoration of Israel, but we have this resurrection of the dead and this instituting of the Feast of Tabernacles that include both Gentile and Jew. The ingathering of all the Jews from around the world and the institution that is foreshadowed tabernacles in the antitype, millennial rest, the climax of international judgment, the international judgment meaning the international world economy, government, all of that is climaxed in that it is finished, it's completed, no longer. It's now under the judgment, the ruling of the hand of God through the Messiah. The fullness of the ingathering of the individual Gentile. Does anybody know what I'm talking about? Have I lost you? I'm talking about the restoration of all things, and you're asking me, well, what is all things? Well, I'm trying to tell you. Here's what's restoration of all things. One of the restorations of all things is the fullness of the time of the Gentiles. That's the one meaning that Peter had about the fullness of all things. That's the last Gentile coming in to the kingdom of Christ at this time. When he comes back, that's the end of the time of the Gentiles. So that's the one of the restoration of all things. The separating of the goats and the sheep nations. That also is a part of the restoration of all things. This setting up of Christ's millennial kingdom. This all comprises what Peter referred to as the restoration of all things. This complete restoration being in view from the garden in both that sure word of Jesus, the sure word of Genesis, 3:15. Remember that sure word of Jesus in Genesis 3:15, don't you? Yeah, about the crushing of his head, the taking away the Satan's authority. And that along with Romans 8:19-23, I think that's significant if for us as Christians to have an understanding of what is the meaning of the restoration of all things. We must understand that all things means all creation as well, don't we? And where we understand that it's the restoration of all things, including creation, we see that in Genesis 3:15 along with Romans chapter 9, where it says, verse 19, where it says, "For the earnest expectation of the creature waiteth for the manifestation of the sons of God. For the creature was made subject to vanity, not willingly, but by reason of him who hath subjected the same in hope. Because the creature itself also shall be delivered from the bondage of corruption into the glorious liberty of the children of God. For we know that the whole creation groaneth and travaileth in pain together until now. And not only they, but ourselves also, which have the first fruits of the Spirit, even we ourselves groan within ourselves, waiting for the adoption, to wit, the redemption of our bodies." So we see that the Genesis 3:15 and the Romans 8:19-23 3 is the revealing, the fullness of the meaning behind the culminating of the sabbatical year and the Jubilee rest. Okay. What's he saying there? Well, the sabbatical year, the seventh year, the sabbatical year that's fulfilled on the Day of Atonement, and the 50th year, which is the Day of the Jubilee, can you see that those are about as much about creation as they are about us? They're much as much about the creature as it is about us. So that is the culminating together, the interconnecting of the Day of the Atonement, the Day of the Lord, the seventh sabbatical year, and this Jubilee has as much to do with God's creation as it has to, that groans with us, right? As it has to do with us ourselves. That which clearly points to the Spirit's words that I just read in anticipation that the whole creation, the earnest expectation of the creature, waiteth for the manifestation of the sons of God. The creature. What does that word creature mean there in Romans chapter 8? It means the sum total of what has been created. The sum total. That's the birds and the bees and the trees and the animals, and that's everything that has been created. It's the sum total. Creature is the sum total of what has been created. That's what the Greek meaning is. It's is full of joy. What is full of joy? The creature is full. It's anticipating. In fullness of joy, the understanding of its permanence. The permanence is reflected in that not only is it the seventh year of sabbatical rest, but in addition, it's also the 50th year of Jubilee. That's the sign of the permanence of the condition, the freedom to the creature. It's awaiting that. They're in perfect prophetic accord with man's restoration, resurrection, and glorification, as they were inextricably united in the curse of God. So justly shall they be united in joyous harmony in the restoration of all things. They were, weren't they? They were cursed at the same time. Creation was cursed at the same time man was. And what can be more meaningful? I asked this question. It came to me. It was rather startling. What can be more meaningful and more spectacular than the pinnacle of all restoration? That of man resurrected from the curse of death, glory-filled and restored with lost body. Is this not the crowning achievement of the atonement of Christ? That struck me. That struck me very deep. The crowning of the atonement of the Messiah. All of this. All of this, what it, the significance is the resurrection from the dead of man, the loss of his, he lost his inheritance, and Christ's crown of atonement is his, man, being resurrected, glorified in body and spirit and soul. That's the crowning achievement of Christ's atonement. Praise God. As far as it relates to man anyway, praise God, that this is that which is shadowed in the Old Covenant sabbatical years and Jubilee in its comparatively minor restorations. The substance is most assuredly found in the greatest of restorations of freedom, the resurrection out from among the dead. Think of it. Mankind not only restored but glorified and established forever as the sons of God. That's the substance of that that's been shadowed in the sabbatical years, the Jubilee, all of those things are the shadowing, but the substance is this complete restoration of man is glorifying and establishing forever as the Son of God. We who were cast out from our rightful inheritance, we were cast out from the earth, right? Man. We were cast out from our rightful inheritance, cast out from the earth. which was given by God to our father Abraham. Huh? Yeah. What'd I say? Abraham? Yeah. Was given to our father Adam, but was lost through sin and through the curse of death. They are now, once again, through living faith in the Messiah, promised a jubilee of new life and a place of preeminence in the restored earth and the kingdom of Christ. This is the prize of the high calling, an inheritance in the lost paradise of earth, redeemed and then esteemed and finally glorified citizens of a redeemed and glory-filled earth. Well, I don't know about you, but when I think in terms of man being falling, rebelling against God, actually, and then God cursing man with death and losing not only a place in this earth, but losing the place in the earth. I mean, he's dead. He's consigned to another place. He had an inheritance in this earth. Each one of us had an inheritance in this earth through our father Adam. But having lost that, we are under that curse, which includes us being cast out of our rightful place. That meaning out of this earth, even having to be a participant in the death curse. That's pretty severe. That's pretty final. And think about it. For thousands of years, people have been lying. That's metaphorically. They are lying in the grave. They're awaiting for the judgments of God, the final judgments of God. And that some will be redeemed and esteemed enough that they'll be glorified citizens again and fill the earth. They'll fill the earth with God's glory. And then I gave you those ought to be familiar scriptures to you by now, Philippians 3:14, where Paul speaks in terms of the high calling and the prize of the high calling, which is the resurrection out from among the dead. And then 1 Corinthians 9:24, when he speaks of the race and the winning of the prize. So in those two scriptures, you can find the reality, the truth of this inheritance of the lost paradise of earth for those that are faithful in Christ. Kathy?
I mean, I'm excited about the prize, but I stand in awe of the reward, which is the new earth. We won't get to the new earth without having obtained the prize. But being a part of the new earth and the new Jerusalem, to me, that is the ultimate outcome of all of this. Mm. And that's what compels me to not just go for the prize, but be part of it so I can be part of that new earth.
Yeah. I think that's true, that in progression, you would be thinking in terms of the gift, the prize, and then the glory filling, which has to do with that glorious new Jerusalem and having a part in that. That the more that you meditate on it, the more you think about it, the more that becomes something to set your affections upon.
Well, I was reflecting on Moses being drawn out of the water and how as we go through this process, the curse and going into being separated from those things that have been ours originally, but now are no more. And it says that he wants a nation of kings and priests. Well, the priest's inheritance is the Lord himself. And Kathy just summed it up, talking about the New Jerusalem. He is the ultimate. Coming into the New Jerusalem, we are in, our inheritance is fulfilled in all that he is. Yeah. We don't have to worry about what was lost with Adam here, but what is gained by joining ourselves to him there.
Right. just as in what we could have just been resurrected and placed back into this earth and have our place, he has done more than that, in that he has resurrected us, glorified us, and put us into a new place, a new heavens and a new earth. I see what you're saying in progression. It's a wonderful thought. I agree. Then besides the Philippians 3:14 and 1 Corinthians 9:24, there's also the Holy Spirit giving us in 1 Peter 1, 3 through 5, another aspect of the same feature. And I'll read that. We're going to really finish timely today. 3 through 5, it says, blessed. Blessed. You know, blessed is a consequence of this side of the equation. This is blessed over here. So blessed, Peter says, be the God and the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, which according to his abundant mercy hath begotten us again unto a lively hope by the resurrection of Jesus Christ from the dead, to an inheritance incorruptible and undefiled, and that fadeth not away, reserved in heaven for you, who are kept by the power of God through faith unto salvation, ready to be revealed at the last time. That's just another way of what Paul expressed in Philippians and in Corinthians. It's the prize. And so also that great day of atonement is portrayed in 1 Corinthians 15:52. This great day of atonement that we're speaking about is referenced in 1 Corinthians 15:52, where it says, at the last trump, for the trumpet shall sound, and Christ will come forth. He'll come forth from where? He'll come forth from the holy place, from behind that curtain. He'll come forth in that he, Christ, was offered once to bear the sins of mankind and will appear a second time, not to deal with sin, because sin, as it relates to the new man anyway, but to bring salvation to those who eagerly await him. So in that we are understand that God is Christ is coming back for those that are the new creation, in that we are not expecting a reckoning that has to do with this side of the atonement, but a reckoning that has to do with this side. He's not coming back again to deal with the sin. He's coming back to deal in the realm of the salvation. That's a great scripture, I think, that brings the focus to where it should be. Christ coming again as king to reckon with those good and bad stewards and those who would not that he should reign over them in his kingdom. What? It goes back to what I was talking to you about earlier, in that it's not only a day that has to do with the remission of sins, the expiation of sins, but it's a day that has to do with a reckoning. And that reckoning is most clearly seen for us in new creation as we are stewards of Christ. And those scriptures, Matthew chapter 13, being explicit in my mind, referencing all of those, including ourselves, as being sown into the earth, and either being a good tear or a bad tear, and how Christ, when he returns on the Day of Atonement, how he deals with the good and the bad seed. How he deals with it. Well, he sends forth his angels. When does he send forth his angels? He sends forth his angels at the time of his return, and he gathers unto himself the good seed, and he does with that what he does with the bad seed. That's brought out in Matthew chapter 13, very clearly, and you should be able to see your own life in that. And then in Matthew 25, we could speak in terms of the ten virgins, but we won't. We'll just skip straight to the scriptures that have to do with the kingdom of heaven in verse 14, where it says, for the kingdom of heaven is as a man traveling into a far country who called his own servants and delivered unto them his goods. And so we can see from that scripture that he has given unto us each this, our gift. He is received unto himself his servants and gave unto each one of them the gift. And then when he returns, this man who is traveling to a far country, and he comes back to receive unto himself his kingdom, we find this throughout the rest of Matthew 25 unto the end of the chapter, a reckoning with each one of his servants, that's us, on this day, that he finds with some of us, he will hopefully with all of us, he will find us faithful, and then some he finds unfaithful. And then probably the most scripture that awakens me or alerts me the most to the awesome reality of what we're speaking is Luke chapter 19. And it's the same reference in verse 12, 19:12, where he says, a certain nobleman went into a far country to receive for himself a kingdom and then to return. And he called his 10 servants and delivered them 10 pounds each. Again, referencing Christ, his servants, the gift, and you and I now as stewards in the earth of his gift. And that he goes away into a far country, meaning into the Holy of Holies as a minister for our benefit, in that he ever liveth to make intercession, and that he will come back. And it says when he came to pass, he returned, and having received the kingdom, the millennial kingdom, his kingdom, then he commanded these servants to be called unto him to whom he had given the money, that he might know how much every man had gained by trading. What have you done with that I have given you? And it's the same dynamic as found in Matthew chapter 13, as found in Matthew 25. But here, the last verse dealing with this reckoning is very frightening to me. It's verse 27 where it says, but those mine enemies, which would not that I should reign over them, bring them hither and slay them before me. So there is a reckoning that goes beyond his servants and goes beyond condemning. There's a condemning part of the reckoning. Those that are his enemies that would not have him reign over them in this kingdom, they won't be there. So this reckoning is not based only on sin, which he defeated upon Calvary, and he bestowed eternal life graciously upon all mankind who would receive that part of the atonement, but also upon the basis of a life-quickening spirit. You see, he is a life-quickening spirit, isn't he? 1 Corinthians chapter 15 speaks in terms, I think it's 52. It speaks in terms of the first Adam was a living soul, but the second Adam was a life-quickening spirit, meaning that you and I, having received the gift, have now a renewed, live, living spirit, and that the source of the quickening into that spirit for the growth of Christ's likeness comes from this life-giving spirit, the second Adam. So 1 Corinthians 15:45 speaks of this nature that goes beyond just sin. It is the sin nature. In those who yield to the power of the Holy Spirit to bring about the change into Christ's likeness. That's the effectiveness of the second Adam. And the pouring out of the Holy Spirit is in the quickening of our spirits, that if we'll yield to the Spirit, capital S, little s, and we'll allow our consciences to be purged, or allow our consciences to purge us If we'll stay in that communion with the Spirit, the life-giving Spirit, then we'll have life and life more abundantly. That means the changing into the likeness of Christ. That is appropriating on the greater, major grace. That is receiving that, which Christ esteems in us. And when He comes back, the judgments that He reckons on this day is the state of this part of the atonement that we're in. That's how He reckons with each of us, according to what state we are in on that side of the atonement. How much of the life-giving Spirit have we drawn upon to bring about His nature? How much have we used the talent, the gift, the money, the silver, that which He gave us? How much of it have we multiplied, and that we have now can receive a reward from Him? Well, Revelations chapter 19. My mind works differently, I know, than a lot of people's minds. But my mind worked very systematically and chronologically in order that when I see the realities of this truth, I know that Revelation 19 and 20, at least 26 through 26, is that time frame that represents the Day of the Atonement, and that right before that day, I mean just very shortly before that day, and that few days that are following the Day of Atonement, that if you read Revelation chapter 19 and 20 through verse 6, you'll get a good order of what will happen on the Day of Atonement. Okay, so what does happen in 19 and 20? Well, what happens is that the Son of God, the King of Kings, rides in on a horse, doesn't He? And on his vesture, and on his thigh, the name is written King of Kings and Lord of Lords. And He cried with a loud voice, saying to all the fowls that fly in the midst of heaven, come and gather yourselves together unto the supper of the great God. This great supper of God is at the Day of the Atonement, that you may eat the flesh of the kings and the flesh of captains and the flesh of mighty men and the flesh of horses and of them that sit on them, and the flesh of all men, both free and bond, both small and great. And I saw the beast and the kings of the earth and their armies gathered together to make war against Him that sat on the horse and against His army. And the beast was taken, and with him the false prophet that wrought miracles before him, with which he deceived them that had received the mark of the beast and them that worshipped his image. These both were cast alive into a lake of fire burning with brimstone. What am I talking about? I'm talking about the Day of the Lord. I'm talking about the Day of Atonement. And the remnant, how does the Day of Atonement have any significance to me in the new covenant? Well, I'm trying to tell you. And the remnant were slain, and the remnant were slain with the sword of him that sat upon the horse. Who's that? And the remnant, that's just anybody that's left. The remnant were slain with the sword of him. The remnant of anybody that had been following after the beast or the prophet, they were slain by the sword of him that sat upon the horse, which sword proceeded out of his mouth, and all the fowls were filled with their flesh. This is the day of vengeance. This is the day of our Lord. This is the great day of atonement. This is the days right before and the right after, a few before and a few after. You're going to see the fulfilling of those scriptures, and by the Lord's sword that comes out of his mouth, we'll see the vengeance of the Lord and the millions of people, the blood flowing. And then in verse 20, or chapter 20, it says, and I saw an angel come down from heaven, having the key of the bottomless pit and a great chain in his hand. How does the Day of Atonement have anything to do with me? That's a Jewish thing. No, this Day of the Atonement, this great Day of the Lord, is the day that an angel takes a chain and he binds up this dragon, old serpent, which is the devil, Satan, and binds him up and throws him into a bottomless pit. That's pretty significant to you and me, isn't it? Hey, yeah, boo. Amen. Amen. Boo. Yeah, this is very significant. Very significant to the New Covenant believer as to what happens on the Day of Atonement, the Day of the Lord. And he cast him into the bottomless pit and shut him up and set a seal upon him that he should deceive the nations no more till the 1,000 years should be fulfilled. The 1,000-year millennial reign, that seventh-day rest, the sabbatical year, the kingdom of Christ, the kingdom of heaven. Oh, that is what is being fulfilled here in that 1,000-year period. Why? That God can fulfill all of those promises that he gave to the forefathers that had to do with Israel. In that he will fulfill all of those promises within that 1,000-day period when the Gentile nations will come in and esteem highly the nation of Israel, etc. And then he, Satan, will be let loose for a short period of time at the end of that 1,000-year period. That's all the Word says in regard to that. Then verse 4 says, and I saw thrones. Okay, when did he see these thrones? Paul or John? John saw these thrones at the day of the Lord, the great day of the Lord. He saw in this vision, along with all of this that's happening, Satan being bound, first those millions of people being slaughtered in the day of vengeance, then the binding of Satan and the false prophet, and seeing them cast into the bottomless pit. Then now he sees thrones being set up. Thrones where? Thrones in the kingdom. Thrones in the millennial kingdom. Those thrones that the Lord will have set up for those that he esteems. Those that have been working out their salvation with fear and trembling. Those that have had their souls purged, cleansed. Those that are in the process of being wise and hewing out for themselves vessels for oil. For those he now establishes thrones. And they sat upon them, and judgment was given unto them. Judgment. Aren't we to rule and reign with Christ? Not only that, we are to rule with a rod of iron, and we'll break forth those pots, those things that are not established in Christ. We'll break them like they were, you know, with great authority, in other words. We won't have just a little authority. We'll have great authority in Christ. Do you suppose we can judge and be in Christ and rule and reign with him if we haven't in the most little insignificant things in ourselves taken any authority? I would suggest to you that if we haven't yielded in those things here in this earth, that we won't be fit to rule and reign. But I would also suggest to you that you might be shocked as to how little that you have to take dominion over in this world to show that you have merit for the next. I have to say that. I have no idea what I'm saying. But I don't want to just be on this extreme. You know, man, if we're not just perfect, we're never going to be able to do this. That's not the reality. That's not practical. And if God was looking for that, then we might as well give up, pack up, go home. So there is on this other side, I think we're going to be surprised as, well, I didn't think you'd be here. Or I didn't think I'd be there. He's good. You know, the last will be first and the first shall be last. You know, there's a lot to be said about the exponential work of God that he can do in such a short period of time. We think in terms of, God, we've been grinding and grinding and I'm no better than this after 50 years. Oh my, I haven't hardly a chance. But the reality is God is able, isn't it? He said to them, it's impossible to men, but it, all things are possible to God. This is not all work and sweat. A lot of this is joy. When you serve God with joy, that's a lot of merit in serving God with joy. You know, you may be full of stuff. You may be filthy all over. But boy, if you're serving God with joy, I tell you, there's something about that God likes. And when you can be clean and fit and be doing all the works, but you have no joy because you have no... You haven't anchored your heart on the things of God. You're all about sweating out the small detail. It's not near as pleasing, is it? I know there's something bubbly about a kid that comes bouncing in, you know, that's been all, he's just filthy. He's just been into whatever. You know, maybe it's a honey jar. He's got it everywhere throughout the pantry all over himself. But he comes bouncing in there, throwing this stuff. There's just something forgiving about his nature. And then there's a kid that has all his stuff all over him and he's drooling it all over your couch. And he has no, there's nothing, no smile, no, he's just causing havoc. You know, I don't know what I'm saying, but you're relating to what I'm saying. I'm trying to say, let's not paint the picture all doom and gloom here. God is able. He's capable. And if we have a heart that pants after Him, that's worth something. And if we have joy and gratefulness, oh God, thank You for the opportunity. Thank You for opening my eyes to the possibilities. Thank You, Lord God, for being long-suffering with me. Gratitude.
The first kid that comes about me, he's full of gratitude. Yeah. That's the difference.
Yeah.
It's just shifting your focus.
Yeah.
And like you were saying, when you clear the way for the Lord, when you clear the way, when you willfully, when you try to get rid of that stuff in your soul, He can come in and make your way straight.
Yeah.
If you'll just clear the way.
Yeah. See, I don't want to demean the necessity of our intense need to be alert, awake, alive unto the things of God. But I don't also want to put so much significance on those things that we forget the empowering hand and loving hand of God.
You know, I'm always thinking, this is something I've thought about a lot here lately, how the word says that we should make Israel jealous. And why would they want anything that we have if we do not, if we're not happy? And it's like I've told the Lord, I know I'm not happy at times. I seek His joy. Put that in me because I don't know what it looks like sometimes. I am weighted down by everything around me that goes on, but I don't want to be that way. I do want to make them jealous. And I really believe that in the midst of a world that's falling apart, when there are people of God who have grabbed onto Him in such a way that we can say, it's bad, but I love Him. He's so good. That people are going to go, I need that.
Yeah.
I need that.
Yeah.
And I want us to be that way.
Yeah.
I want to be that
way. Amen. Amen. And when I took that little poll of this group a year and a half ago, and I just pulled those out, by the way, the other day. They're laying there up close, pinned them together, and they're just looking at them. That attitude of hopelessness, helplessness, despair was so prevalent in this group that I knew that I had polarized us to a certain place. Well, I was awakened to that reality, and I'm still very, how I am, better than I know how I am. But I'm very demanding in the sense of my own life. I know accountability. I know what that means. I know to be a good steward and to be faithful. I know what those things mean. Doesn't mean that you have reached perfection or that you're infallible, but it is that you're in the race. If you're apathetic, you're just not even in the race. But when tears come to mind and to heart and to eye, when you contemplate the things of God, then you are in the race. You are not, you've not fallen out. You've not got an apathetic heart. And the things that we have been exploring together in the Scriptures are supposed to, they are supposed to incentivize us. God has set before us such a great, wondrous prize. And as Kathy said and Liddell said, that if you're going to take it even to the next degree, it's to this New Jerusalem, to the new heavens and the new earth, and a part in that. Those are tremendous, wonderful things if we can get our hearts around them. Yeah, yeah. It's the real. That's the. This is a facade.
Right. Exactly.
That's the real.
We talked about this just the other day.
You and Kim.
What?
You and Kim.
Yeah. Kim and I. God is sovereign and He can do anything and everything. But for some strange reason, I mean, why do we even have to pray? Why can't He just do what He wants to do? I mean, we've talked about this, but there's something about your participation with Him. Doesn't mean you've got to do everything. He just wants a participation. He comes alongside of us to walk with us through this life. He's the great, we're the little. He's the mighty. We're the follower. I mean,
yeah.
We're just participating, but we do have a part to play.
We have a requirement.
Yeah, well, there's a requirement, but we ain't all of everything.
No.
We're never going to toe the line.
No.
He's what?
No. And that should be no excuse for us to wallow in that that God's been convicting our heart in for years. That we can't continue in that and expect an outcome that would be as good as if we would yield to unto the Lord.
Every one of us been involved in the first part of this thing, where that we got our ticket punched and that was good enough. But we don't have to die and go to hell. But we're not there anymore. We know better. We know there's more. We know that we can hear His voice. We feel the hoof beats on the ground. I mean, we know it's close. And
we see it. We should be seeing the rewards clear, and we should be seeing what good deeds are, and we should be seeing what recompense or reward means, and how that we applying ourselves to be Christ-like, what the reward of that is. We should be seeing that, and we should be instituting that in our lives, and we should be putting on and putting off. And if we're putting on and putting off, then we're in the race. We're not relying on this one-time gifting of the eternal life, but we have got our hearts set on something further than that. Good stewards.
What I was trying to say with that, though, where I was going with it, is that we've seen that sloppy agape, or that easy grace thing, and we've been in that long enough, and we've seen what that produces. Lovely, beautiful people, but a mess.
Flesh.
And us ourselves.
Yeah.
And so to take it to the other side and show them the other side of it is really what we've been trying to do all these years, is to bring it the whole picture instead of just a part of it. But not wanting to just fall in a ditch over here, it has to bring back into what you said, seeing what the papers were from a year and a half ago. We've got to bring it all back together again. So not giving anybody license to sin, or to be lazy, or to be apathetic, or the fear is that we've gotten to be older and not spoken the truth to the younger ones.
That's right.
That's the fear, is that we've given up. We've implied that, oh, you're okay. Or even implied that, oh, go ahead and sin, you can always get forgiveness.
I think for me, it's been, I don't want mediocre. My God isn't a mediocre God. He has so much more. And I used to always question, you know, Lord, you could have done that part of those waters all by yourself.
Yeah.
Why did you expect men to do something to make that happen? Because you really didn't need them.
Yeah.
But He wants us to, in obedience, do that. That song, every time I hear on the radio, I crank it up, but I don't want to go through the motions. I don't want to go one more day without your all-consuming passion inside of me.
Amen.
It's that, what you're yes. talking about, it's that calling, that passion.
Yes.
It's like, I there's so much more. I don't want to be mediocre,
right.
You know? That's
right.
Not who my God is, and that's not how I want people to see Him.
It's a yearning for home.
Yeah.
And you know, amen. When you were taught, that's what it is, and that gets squelched, because we get comfy, or we lose hope, or, you know, gosh, told me the other morning, I was driving in my car, and it was still dark out, and I had the thought, and darkness covered the earth. That was my thought. And then I feel like God showed me the earth before it was as we know it now. And it was this formless, brown lump of earth, just around. And it was dark all around it. And He showed me the water coming forth and down, and He baptized the earth. And I saw the grass, and I saw Him take us and grow us up out of the earth. And He was showing me all these examples of the earth bearing fruit, and how you can't separate us from the earth. And our destiny is bound up in earth. So when we have to leave this goes back into the earth. But we all know that this globe we sit on right now is going to be burned in fire. And our old bodies, so thank God we have somewhere else, our spirit man, somewhere else to go, where we get a new glorified earth, glorified bodies, and all that stuff. So yeah, I mean, you just showed me all this stuff, and I just thought, oh, duh, yeah, we're dust, we're earth. And He just, I just keep feeling like he's saying to me, I just need a team down there. I just need a team. He just wants his glory to be able to shine through these earthen vessels. That's insane to all the spiritual beings and principalities to look down at these clumps of dirt and, you know, to have any kind of whatever form. They're like, okay, God, we'll see how this all plays out. But he knows. And for whatever reason, like you're saying, I don't know why he wants me, that he wants us to interact in all this with him or on his behalf. But that's unbelievable. It's humbling. It's encouraging. It's amazing.
Liddell, did your arm get tired?
Well, I reflect on what you were saying about the hopelessness that was in that with those papers that we turned in. And when you think about hope, now faith is the substance of things hoped for. So if you have no hope, there is no faith. And he says, when I return, will there be faith on the earth? So this is part of the crux that I think are occupying now, working out our salvation, that we're about, is getting to that place where we put aside those unworthy suspicions concerning God's faithfulness to us, separate that precious from the vile and the holy from the profane, and lay hold of the grace to empower us with hope, with joy, but with faith.
That's good. I just see my walk with the Lord as Him wanting us to be fully filled with His Spirit, so that we can fully dwell in His presence.
Yes.
And that's the goal He wants for us right now. As we seek to be filled with the Spirit and we seek to dwell in His presence, then we're going to operate in the love, the joy, all the fruits of the Spirit.
Yes.
We're going to have His nature. And we'll be, laying down self is no longer a problem. I just think of that priest that, you know, that had talked about dwelling in the presence. The one that Gino told us about, in the presence of the Lord. It's not a hard thing to obtain if that's what our desire is as soon as we wake up in the morning. I mean, that's why I ask the Lord, fill me with your Spirit. Let me dwell in your presence today, so that I can fulfill your purpose in my life and not my own purpose.
Amen. Set your affections on things above. And John had it in that when he wrote 1 John, he wrote that about the love of the world. And what we're talking about here is separating ourselves from the love of the world and loving God and not having mediocrity. Mediocrity is just having a love for the world more than you have a love for God. I have no desire to have mediocrity because that's the love of the world. My heart must be fixed. We must fix our heart. And that's not going to happen naturally. You know, it's not, you're just not naturally like a child. You're young and you grow old, but in spiritual things, that's not the way it works. You can always stay a child. Unless you set yourself to grow up, you'll always stay a child. And unless you set yourself to grow out of the things of the world and for the things of God, you'll remain in the things of the world. Well, praise the Lord. I thought we'd be done earlier, but I'm almost done. That's the last page. Praise the Lord. Matter of fact, did I finish? No. Oh, I'm at summarize? Yeah. To summarize, Yeshua filled up with meaning the Day of Atonement, that of the Mosaic Law of Leviticus 16. This fulfilling of the Mosaic Law by the Lord is seen reasonably clear, I believe, if you understand that that's what it's saying in Hebrews 8 through 10, chapters 8 through 10. And then very specifically in Hebrews chapter 9, verse 14 and 15, where it says, how much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal, in other words, how much more shall the blood of Christ, the blood of animals, right, had an efficacy, but how much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal Spirit offered himself without spot to God, purge your conscience from dead works to serve the living God. And for this cause, he is the mediator of the New Testament, that by means of death, for the redemption of the transgressions that were under the First Testament, they which are called might receive the promise of eternal inheritance. So this is just the understanding of Christ fulfilling in himself the meanings of the Day of Atonement. The Old Covenant primarily dealt with sin. You know, I could write up here in the Minor Grace, I could write here Old Covenant and put it in parentheses, because the Old Covenant dealt primarily with sin. It didn't. There wasn't efficacy enough in the blood of animals to carry us over into the major grace. That's why there was no major grace in the Old Covenant. That's why there was a renewing and a redoing of a new covenant, is so that we might have a more power to apply to our nature. So the Old Covenant primarily dealt with sin, as that was the extent of its propitiation. The New Covenant deals with sin and the sin nature as a result of the greater efficacy of atonement, the meaning behind the purging of the conscience. Dealing with the sin only has to do with the state of the spirit. Dealing with the sin nature has to do with dealing with spirit, soul, and body. The greater atonement has to do with not only a coming out, but a going in. Christ's atonement was twofold, as sin was dealt with once and for all in the shedding of his blood and his death on the cross. The sin nature was dealt with in the grave, resurrection, and coronation. Through his atonement, we first perceive our spirit's salvation in that we are freed from the land of the master of sin. But his atonement fullness is in vain in regard to us if we do not avail ourselves entirely of the resurrection power unto the salvation of our soul by the gift of the power of the Holy Spirit, and that with the sure reward of inheritance in the kingdom of the Messiah as an overcomer. But as it relates to the atonement, as it relates to that one-time event in the future, the day of the Lord, with its many prophetic promises following, is yet unfulfilled. Amen? Hallelujah. I appreciate all of your comments. And any further comments? Yeah, well, that tape may have one more hour, but this boy don't have one more hour.
A good picture, Mike, is like spirit, soul, and body. Spirit is Romans 6, soul is Romans 7, and body is Romans 8.
Yep. That's right. The spirit is Romans 6, the soul is Romans 7, and the body is Romans 8. So in dealing with spirit, soul, and body, I don't think there's any clear description in Scripture than Romans 5 through 8, 5:13 more specifically. That has to do with this dynamic. Paul explains what has happened here, and then he explains what should happen on beyond this. In this, if we stop and take no dominion, then we become again mastered by our flesh. Even though we haven't lost our eternal salvation, we've lost our redemption in regard to our strength to overcome. You're overcome or you're overcoming. There's no in-between ground. The line is definitive. Here's this pressing this way and this pressing that way. And the line's definitive. It's not these going this way and there's get this gap of void, a vacuum of nothing. Either overcoming or you're overcome. And Romans 5, 6, 7, and 8 gives a great explanation of how that dynamic works, especially in the being married under the law and then being free from the law through the death, through your death, and how then that you are now fit, able to wed unto Christ. The law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus has set me free. That's the law that we're under. And that's the law on this side. The law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus. That's what rules over here. This is what we draw upon. We draw upon the outpouring of the Holy Spirit, not through the law of observing the law, but we pull upon the power of the Holy Spirit by the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus, which is always ascertaining, considering, judging itself. Where am I at? What have I done? What am I doing? What do I need to have again to have the blood to resprinkle the conscience, that I have dirtied and soiled myself with in life? That's the law of the Spirit of life in Christ Jesus. Blah, blah. I'll shut up. Jim? I'd like you to come right up here and take your time, and I'll listen.
This first word right here, let's say that just prior to that, there's trumpets, taking off the trumpet, however it's shouted. And a trumpet, when the trumpet sounds in Israel, it could be a lot of things. First of all, maybe it has to do with a crisis, some crisis for the community to gather together. And one of the things that could be that is that there's going to be judgment. So that's one side of the equation, that when the Lord's about to do something, there'll be some kind of judgment or separation between that which is pleasing to him and that which is not pleasing to him. Another thing that would happen when the trumpet sounded, they had different sounds. When the trumpet would sound for a king coming, it was one sound. For judgment, that was another thing. For you have to repent and afflict your souls that 10-day period. They knew the sound of that trumpet. And that would tell them these are days of affliction for your soul. And so then man tries his best to clean up and, okay, I'll be good. And I got 10 days to get ready and pay all my debts and so on. So that's still big when you are with Orthodox Jews who take that extremely seriously. And Rami took us when we were in Israel, either the time before or the time before, for Kol Nidra, which is the day when you actually come together and try to afflict your souls and get rid of yourself. But the problem with that is you can't.
Yeah.
The problem is we've all tried that.
Yeah.
Scott was referring to that earlier about, okay, I'm going to kill off my old man and get rid of him. You can preach to the cows come home, but you're still going to have it. You can't erase it. So that's the first thing. So the king is coming. He's coming, and so that could be exciting if the king likes you. But if he doesn't, that could be the trouble. So the king is going to get an accounting. He's going to reckon with people. Another thing it could be is that it could be that a bride, he's going to get married, and his bride needs to be ready for the marriage supper of the Lamb. So that's a different kind of thing. That's exciting. Except again, there'll be the foolish virgins and the wise virgins. So, for some that'll be great news, and for others it'll be, hey, he's coming, and the others like, yeah, they don't have any oil, and so on. So, you got all these problems. Another is, and there's lots of different reasons why you call together. For example, harvest. That's another thing. There's a kind of a joyful harvest. He's ready. All the crops are coming in, and now we're going to celebrate over that. And so you have all these different things that could go on. There's about 8 or 10 of them. That when you hear a trumpet, it has a certain sound, and it's telling you to get ready. So that's the first thing, and that's called trumpets. So that festival is related here to the judgment. That's one side of what you talked about, this side. And then also the king coming, the marriage supper, the harvest, and many other things. But when you get to atonement and you pass that 10-day period, either here and you get a bad judgment, because a whole bunch of people on the Day of Atonement are going to realize I'm not ready, and I had 10 days to get ready and I didn't get it all done. I didn't pay off all my debts. I didn't do everything that Jesus wanted. I'm not perfect. And so it's kind of sad because, geez, I hope I'm in.
and you're kind of hoping. But for Christians, for the new covenant, that's not a possibility for us. But as we also know, there can be a separation from the sheep and the goats. And so some who call themselves Christians aren't going to be ready. So they're actually going to be no better off than the judgment ones, because they're going to fall into the judgment. But those that go with Yeshua HaMashiach, that his cross is not, you know, our death, our cleaning up, but he died and he cleaned up. You know, his life is my life. And so for those that are bridal, it's like, wow, thank you, Jesus, because I couldn't clean up. I couldn't get ready. I didn't know how to have a pure heart and soul and body. I mean, that was a lot. So this atonement then is my cleansing, because I have passively, on this side of the atonement, I let Jesus die for me and live for me and resurrect for me, and he does all of that. So the atonement's a joyful day for that group. However, as your whole message has always been, is that's not the full picture. That's only part of the picture. So atonement is judgment for many, and judgment for many Christians who aren't really going on with Christ. They stop there, and that was a door. That was a wall rather than a door. It's like, hey, stop right there. You're done. Finished. You got the righteousness of Christ. It's over with. But if you pass through and you go from the one goat to the other goat, you're set free. Now there's no pressure. There's no law. There's no judgment on me. However, I could just then sin. I could just say, hey, why not sin until the Lord comes back? Because I'm having all my confidence that Jesus died for me. Why? I don't have to die. But we know the scripture says, take up your cross. So the reason why you have to teach that is because if you never hear it, you wouldn't even know about it. You'd just think, yeah, believe, only believe. It says that somewhere there, only believe. I'm in, I'm okay. I do believe, I'm excited. But the truth is, it doesn't say that. As a matter of fact, the more you look at it, the more you find there's like a billion scriptures that say just men made perfect. I wonder if that's only belief. Well, yeah, I guess believing is perfect. Yeah, okay. And so you try to smash everything back to this side if you can. But these scriptures keep coming. You know, and it talks about fruit bearing and all this stuff, and you realize, I'm kind of naked right there. So atonement then will be horrible for multitudes. Multitudes in the valley of decision. So this day that's right here, prior to booths, prior to the third or the seventh covenant, the seventh festival, that one can be a turning point for many people. But it shouldn't be a mystery to us, as you were saying. It should actually be exciting that it's all written. It's all there in the Old Testament by type, and in the New Testament, anti-type. So we can see that this trumpet says, get ready. Whatever it's saying is, get ready. The Lord's about to say something. And if you have the fear of the Lord, you humble yourself, or you stop what you're doing. It's also a day of rest, because there's no more labor. There's no more labor. But I can misunderstand anything you say about anything up here. You can misunderstand it. So that's what we don't want to do, is we don't want to misunderstand it. So by seeking the Word and these teachings, you're making clearer and clearer and clearer how it's not only in the New Testament that, you know, if you'd like to, for extra credit, you could kind of go on to holiness. But that may not be the case. It isn't optional. You know, like, well, at least I started. You know, it's like, no. It's not just heading in the right direction. But for so many pastors and teachers and apostles and prophets and so on, they only teach this. And Christendom has destroyed the gospel and turned it into a law. They've turned it into force and pressure. You know, hey, you're fine. If you get out of line, they put the law on you. And if you're too depressed, they give you some gospel and try to keep you right there. But we know now this is free. This goat here is total freedom and liberty, but obviously not full perfection. Obviously being free.
So what happens to people that depend on the minor grace?
It's a great question. That's a great question. Mike, you want to answer that?
No. You now have the floor.
It's interesting because the Lord has been really kind of revealing to me, and I have not connected all the dots yet, that he has taught me these lessons through my life. Right. And as y'all are teaching, it's all coming back to me. And I'm like, okay, somehow everything that's happened in my life to this point all connects with this. My father died 6 years ago, and I watched him. He lived his whole life in this minor grace,
right,
this old covenant. He depended on the cross of Christ, and I watched him on his deathbed in anguish. He could not speak. He was dying. You could,
right,
tell he was dying.
Right.
Tears running down his face, because about a week before he died, he hand wrote a will that gave his entire estate, everything, which was about $500,000, to a woman that he had married that was,
sure,
basically a harlot,
sure,
honestly,
right,
and had left me with nothing.
Right.
And interestingly enough, he died on her birthday, but I was the one sitting there with him. She had left. She had gone home. I was sitting with him and watching him go through this torment, and I knew in my soul that I was witnessing something bigger,
right,
than just this experience of watching my father die. And it all connects with this. And I still haven't connected all the dots, but I'm like,
yeah,
I watched my dad in that process realize that he had depended on that old covenant,
right,
and he had rested on the fact that Christ died for him, but he never pursued,
right,
Christ. He did,
right,
not move forward. He,
mm,
you know, and just the agony of his soul. So I can, mm, I mean, I can see his face when,
right,
we talk about this. I can see the agony. I'm like, I don't want to live in that ever.
Right.
I don't want to be on my deathbed and realize I didn't move on. I didn't,
right,
move forward.
Right. As you know, you cannot answer that question because only God judges the heart.
Mm-hmm.
But you do know that at least psychologically, soul, self, He was feeling, you know, I don't think I quite did it. I've been okay up until, but now I'm not sure. And the way I'm going about these last few days, so that doesn't say anything about the heart, only God judges the heart. So you can't answer that question unless the Lord reveals it to you. You don't know. And so he's not necessarily lost because of that.
Right.
Nor is he necessarily, you know, but he wasn't taught, so out of ignorance and blah, blah, blah. You have to leave that to God. So we don't answer that. But what I'm sharing here, without answering that one, because you can't, is there's an order to everything God does. And that's why there's seven festivals. And these are the last three. These are the fall ones. And today is this one. And this one here is that because Christ... because Christ did die for us, therefore, we can go on into this until we arrive at this. So we have these three. This is the atonement. The trumpet sounded. Get ready. Something's about to happen. And now we know the order, though. Because, first of all, way back here was the first three festivals in the spring, where we had Passover and unleavened bread and all that, and first fruits and so on. So we know that Christ did this part, spring. And then we had Pentecost, which took us on, took us beyond that to say, now your turn,
yeah,
not just to believe,
yes,
but for faith to be active,
yes,
working,
yes,
in love. And if you don't have that, it makes you nervous, because there's something wrong. But if the preacher doesn't preach that, you're not. He discomforts you to say, oh, you're fine, there's no problem. I would say 90% of pastors are only teaching that. Probably 98, but whatever the number is. And most pastors don't. So the Lord has a problem, because the Lord is the one that loves us. You know, the pastors may just be, they'll have their excuses and so on and so forth, but, you know, whatever happens to all those people, leave that to the Lord. But at least us in this room, at least wherever you are, is, you know, there's a truth here that is definitely not just this. And so I can no longer buy that. I can no longer just say, all you have to do is believe. Only believe. No, no. Believing must be active. There must be perfection. You must go on to perfection. Every book in the Bible teaches it. So that same process that's going on has to bring us to an end point. Who, for the joy that was set before him, endured the cross, despising the shame. So I know I've got to go all the way. Now, if it was up to me, I wouldn't make it. I mean, none of us have that ability. Because why? Because you couldn't eliminate the flesh doing it. I mean, you can have a lot of spirit, but then there'd be a bunch of flesh. So the only thing you can rely upon is have faith in the guy that did this one could help us do this one and get us to this one. So now the question is, does he want to? You know, is that the will of God? And it is. So since that is the will of God, and we have confidence in that, our only blindness was we only knew about this, now we've known about this, and now we've got to get into this. But these festivals are set out for one reason and one reason only: God is love. If God wasn't a loving Father who wanted everyone, he said, I desire not the death of any sinner. Golly, a bunch of people in that group. And he's told us not everyone is going to come. There's only going to be a remnant out of the nations, out of every nation though, out of every nation, tongue, and tribe. And then not everybody that's Christian will make it. We know that. There's foolish and wise and sheep and goats and all those divisions. And not all of Israel. We know there's a holy remnant of Israel that will not just have the temporal blessings for 1,000 years, but will go on to eternity. And they will accept Yeshua HaMashiach, but that doesn't mean everybody that today says they're professing Christ as Messiah. That doesn't mean anything either. It's still, you know, did the Lord do it and did you do it? Did the Lord do it and did you do it? I mean, there's some kind of a love affair here, an intimacy that we're learning about, and let's not answer all those bigger questions that we have, because you can't. Because then it's theoretical and you've taken your eyes off the Lord and what he's doing. Just be the light, be the salt right now. We know enough to go on, and I don't believe it's because of Mike. I don't believe Mike invented the idea and came up with it. Peter had it, Paul had it, and you can tell it's been had before, and over the ages you can see there's always been, and Mike is one, and I'm one, and so on. You can just see there are people that are hungry to go all the way, no matter what. We don't know about the rest, but if we're the light and salt in truth and actually let judgment fall and have the king come and bow to him. Kings make commands, they don't save you. And then brides, they get excited because they're going to be married and so on. But am I spotless? Am I a glorious bride without one spot? And most of the church didn't even think about that. I guarantee you 99% of the pastors don't even teach that or talk about it or structure their churches to do it. I mean, so there's no possibility. So the question is God able? Can God do the impossible? And can he do it quickly, as you said? He's only got, you know, hours left or weeks or months or something. But yes, of course, he will do that. And he's going to have a numberless host out of Israel, out of the church itself, and out of the nations. So however big that group is, you can't number it, because he swore an oath to Abraham. He raised his right hand and said, I swear, you know, your seed is going to be like the sand of the sea and the stars in the sky and so on. So we do know that this message is going to be preached, and in the last days where we're living in, you just need to see the beautiful order that God has rigged up for us here, and it's going to be exactly what he said. It's not going to vary one bit. And there's a fear that comes into you that you have to have. I don't want to miss out. Not a fear like, I'm going to go to hell. But the fear like, I don't want to miss anything that God says, because I obviously know nothing. And the more you know, the more you realize, I don't know anything. But I do. I do. So that psychological humbling ourselves, even during this Day of Atonement, as Mike said, doesn't hurt us to humble ourselves at all. And let's say a little bits of the flesh. It's okay. That doesn't mean everything. Let's say I do something in the flesh, or let's say it's the devil doing it. Yeah, I did it because of the devil. Or let's say it's Jesus. You know what? None of us are smart enough to figure out who's who. You really aren't. But what you can do is rely on the fact that God is good. Amen. And only God is good. And that goodness is working this out so that even though we're not good, we are. Even though we're not, we are. Because what he told us to do, he's actually going to do for us, and then in us, and then work it through us so that men glorify God. I mean, Israel depends upon us, and the nations depend upon Israel. Because if they don't see our good works, they can't glorify the Father. And that's the nations doing it. They don't know Zip. They don't know Moses or Jesus. But if we who are Christians, forget everybody else in the world, just you, just stop with you. Go through this. Hear the trumpet. Know this. Judgment is coming. God, if there's any wicked way in me, get it. You know, that to the king is coming, Lord, tell me what to do and I'll obey. I want to be your trustee. I want to be your servant. Bride, I want to be ready without spot or wrinkle, any such thing. Harvest, yeah, I want everything that's coming and eat it all and enjoy it all. All of these scriptures, and the more you put in the word in you, you hide it in your heart, you won't sin. And you know you've grown. Everybody here wouldn't be here if you weren't growing. Yeah. If you weren't hearing something that you knew was more than that and was this plus, you know, however the Holy Spirit works, because it says he's in me to will, and then it says he's in me to do. So he's not just in me to will. When the Holy Spirit has come, he's going to then be able to take everything that I did, the gift, and bring it into this prize until I move on till everything is perfect. And no one goes to heaven without any sin. You can't go to heaven. You're not going to go to Father's house if you have any sins. So somehow when that trumpet blows, it worked really fast, and then I'm realizing, wow, I'm going to be there. Why? Because I am in love. And now, I don't know what you say to yourself each day, but you need to say that to yourself each day is, thank you, Jesus, you're everything to me, and I love you with all my heart. Just tell me what to do, I'll do it. Tell me what to say, I'll say it. Tell me what not to say and what not to do, because you know me, I can ruin anything. So you have to have that kind of humility before God, but not like the Jewish people who are stuck. But their hope is not in just God. He made the promises, they know about them, but they're not dwelling on that. They're trying to keep Torah. Are you keeping Torah? Are you keeping Torah? Are you keeping Torah? Well, at least one day of the year we're going to do it. That's not good enough, but we're the problem. Let judgment begin in the household of God, not among the Jewish people, among the worldly people. They don't have any light. And today, while we're going through the hell, you at least know that you can go through this with joy. Because the rest of this part of the church does not want to suffer. Jesus suffered, good. That's the end of that. But I don't want to take up my cross. I don't want to die. I don't want to love my wife as Christ loved the church. I don't want to do, you know, all those things that are going to cause trouble to my soul, to myself, until I'm dead. But at least you here, you know that your death is everything. As a matter of fact, the whole gospel is about death and resurrection. It's about, you know, you have to die daily. You don't just die one time like Jesus, because it's perfect. You have to daily die to yourself and know that this atonement thing is joy for us. However, it also, at the same time, because we're in the world still and we go through all this, your prayer, see, a lot of people just say, well, I'm the righteous of Christ, so that's the end of that. No, it's not. I also have to participate in that and be part of what God is doing. And how do I know whether it's me or the devil or Jesus or whatever it is? But I do know one thing. God, help me here. I want everything you have, and I know you love me. And I'm going to dwell on your love for me whenever I bog down, not mine for you. And I know I've got some, but I want all. I don't want anything lacking, like a bride who's making herself ready for her husband. So the biggest thing here then is, I want all of it. I want all the trumpets. Just blow every one of them. You know, the harvest is coming, the bride, the king, the judgment, the everything. I want it all. And however I get that is, you want to listen to preachers like Mike and others who would tell you, go all the way. And then they lay it out detail by detail, by boring detail, by boring detail, by complex detail. It's great.
Yep.
There's nothing like it. Yep. You can see the multitudes are not here. Yeah. But it's okay, because their hope is not in them. Their hope is certainly not just here where they have false hope. Their hope is in getting over to here, and then they're still a long way from here. But let them go through all of it. And when they see us, who knows how quickly that could have an impact on them. I think the world is really hungry. The harvest is ripe. Apparently it's the laborers that are few. So let's say we were the only ones in Fort Worth. It's enough. It's more than enough. Mm-hmm. We could even divide the room in half. It's still enough, you know. You could even have just two or three.
Yep.
It's amazing how keep your eyes off of everybody else and how he's going to work it out. I believe the love of God is going to use judgment for your benefit. Is going to be, you know, he's our king and our only king. And the king that he's king over is obviously not evil kings, Herod, Pilate. He's obviously king over the righteous. So we're the righteous king. You're a kingdom of priests and kings. So you're a royal priesthood. So if we have ears to hear and everyone doesn't, don't worry about that. Just pray for them. But mostly, just let the judgment begin with you. So I want every day's judgment to come. So there is no one day of atonement. For me, it's every day. Every day, I wake up every day, 3 or 4 in the morning, every day. And I'm going to pray for at least 4 or 5 hours, 6 hours, whatever. I'm not going to quit. I love it. I'm in the Word, and I know Mike does the same. I don't know if you do it at 3, do you?
4. I'm a 4 guy.
Cross 3. No, but the truth is, I really am in love. I'm totally dead to this world, and I totally love my wife, and I totally love my kids, blah, 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 blah. But I want all the death I can get. I want his death to be the key to my death, because as he loves me, love kills me. Love doesn't just save me, but it wants to kill me so then it can resurrect me. Because this is the only love that is called perfect love. This love is the beginning. This love is enduring, that I'm dying slowly, 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 daily, daily, daily. But this one is perfect love where I actually see the fruit and I know it. And I'm so in love, I'm not a little child anymore. I'm not just a young man, but it's mature. Amen. I think that's the joy. That Amen. Even in this world, before the marriage even takes place, you just have the betrothal now. You're already so in love that you don't care about this world. I know it's true of Mike. I know it's true of Patty and many others in this room. But I just tell you, this is exciting. I mean, I love every detail of all this stuff that Mike has to dig out week after week. I just love it how he can do all of that. Yeah.
I've been trying to hang on to my thoughts and listen to these. That's kind of hard.
Right.
But I think that God is raising up a new generation. And I've often wondered the same thing. Like, just thinking about your dad. Would God accept some sort of a deathbed conversion? Because in that last split second, somebody got it.
Sure.
We don't know about that. But the point is, we're hearing this. We're getting this. He's stirring us with this. We're not the only pocket of people this is happening with.
Exactly.
So every day that goes by, his coming is getting closer. He needs us to have a higher understanding, a deeper hunger and conviction. He needs heralds. Prepare the way. Oh, you heard he was coming? Okay, get this. He's here. Like, I hear him. So, and if your life, what did Mike say? He talked about the life quickening spirit. No life is life without that. That life quickening spirit. That, we see glimpses of that in the Old Testament. You know, the spirit, God took the spirit from Saul, blah, blah, blah. But with Mary, we see that with Mary, the life quickening spirit. That's what brought Jesus forth on this earth. Even with Elizabeth, for John, for the herald to prepare the way. What was the other thing I said? Something about resurrection power. She was barren. So it started then, and we are all to be John.
Right.
You're not going to be John on your own. Please take it from me. No matter how much determination and will and your thoughts and your, like, it's not going to happen. It's not going to happen.
Right.
But,
it's good.
It's the life quickening power through us, because if you don't have real life and you're going, prepare the way, here he comes, people are going to look at you and go, whatever, yeah, right, you and him have fun with all that. I'm having fun right now.
Right.
And that's what I see when I see the girls dressed like men and the men dressed like girls and the angry people and the lost and the scared people beg God for their salvation.
Amen.
That's what they're missing. And they're living life, and they're rich, and they're partying, and they have all this success, and they're dead.
Right.
All I see is be so, and may they come along.
Perfect.
Because he has a party, and he wants everybody there.
Right.
And it's going to come down to you choosing. He's not going to do it for you. It's just like we can't choose for our kids. Oh, I would love to make good choices for my kids, and I try every day.
Right.
That just doesn't work.
Yeah, it doesn't work.
But if I can teach my children the value of maintaining a healthy connection with me, then they will learn the importance of making good choices so we can be close. God's always teaching me about him and I with me and my kids. So, and I have to have that life quickening spirit.
Head southwest on Randall Mill Road.
I don't want to go southwest.
So he's telling me where to go.
Let me just throw some this. This is like the outer court. This is like the holy place. And this is like the holy of holies. I don't care whose theology. That's the correct one. You've got to move from this one to this one to this one. However you get there. This is faith. This is hope. This is love. The only thing that people see, not this, and not this. They don't see your spirit. They don't see your soul. Those are two inward. The only thing they see is your works. The only thing is your outer. What comes out of the Holy of Holies, because the high priest comes back out. After he goes in, he comes back out. And when he does that, when men see your good works, they'll give glory to the Father in heaven. That's what's missing today.
Amen.
Talk, talk, lots of talk. But walk. When you're born of the Spirit, that's good. When you're filled with the Spirit, that's better. And when you're led of the Spirit, that's the sons of God.
Amen.
This is where we haven't gotten to the bridal company yet, because we're still here, and almost no one is here. So it's like going to Israel right now. No big crowds. Nobody wants to go when there's trouble time. But the best has been saved to the last. And just as God was able when everything was nothing, all of a sudden he took water, turned it into wine. He took that which man could do, and then he did something that only God could do. So God can do that with us. So if you could just get a handful of people today, it'd be enough. One man, the prayer of one is enough to change nations and so on and so forth. So imagine if you had 10 or 12 or 15 or 30. That's what Jesus did. He is not only not losing, he's still winning. I go all over the world. I go just like Mike does. And everywhere I go, Christianity is thriving. And people are to the death wanting to serve Jesus, whether it's India or China or Russia or Israel or all over Africa or wherever it is. There is such ripeness to hear truth. And not just preaching. See, this is just preaching. But you have to do the teaching here. This is the part they hate. Here I'm a believer, here I'm a disciple, but here I'm a lover. There's almost no lovers. Now there's always a few, no matter what happens. Maybe a hymn changes them or something. But there's always some that are serious about him and will grow. So the more scripture you get and the more it comes alive, and this is what, you know, what Mike has done is going into the Old Testament, into those, particularly in the Torah, but into those passages which are so far, far away, they're not. They're everything. If you don't have those roots, you can't enjoy these fruits. This is, without roots here, that's why people fall back into legalism and license. That's the problem. But how quickly they could turn back again if they saw the kingdom of God, if they heard the words alive in people, not Jesus coming back, but in Jesus coming today. Let thy kingdom come. We were talking about that yesterday. Let thy kingdom come today in me right now. And let it come with judgment. And let it come with, you know, lordship. And let it come with bridal purity and so on and so forth. Let all of this happen then so that we can enjoy booths together. And booths, one of the biggest things there is that Jew and Gentile come together. The only time in Israel's deal that they're not separated. It's the only time when they unite. And they have to, under the law, invite some Gentiles in. And so it's a pain, but still they have to do it. And they have to have fruit, and, you know. And I remember a few years ago when we were in Israel, and these older people with the numbers on their arm, they would come up to you on the street and say, "I want you to come to our house and, you know, share our festival, the Festival of Booths," which is, that is the biggest festival. That's the greatest joy. It's not the holiest, but it's the joyous one.
Yes.
Especially Simchat Torah.
Yes.
That one is the greatest of all. But they wanted us to be part of their impeccable booth that they had made. And it had to be perfect. It was just perfect. I'm sure you experienced it. And yeah, they're beautiful. But the beauty is that they wept. And they said, "We know why you came. You didn't come to be a tourist. You came because you love Israel." That was so accurate. I mean, it was like, yeah, that's exactly why we're here. We're not here to, we've already been umpteen times. We're here to share the gospel, but to live it. Now, they didn't expect you to be living it, because they know Christians haven't gotten anywhere. They're not even working that hard. So they're not really that impressed with Christians. They give them scriptures. It's an Old Testament scripture right there. What they want to see is the love. And when they see that you'd be willing to die with them and for them, that's Jesus. That's Jesus. So we didn't even do it here with our own churches, and because all we do is, "Well, thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus." Okay, that's good. But thanksgiving is not the same as praise, and praise is not the same as powerful, in love, adoration. "I love you. I love you. I love you. I love you." My prayers, it's really easy to do thanksgiving. "God, thank you for the sun today," and blah, 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 and all this stuff. And then, "I praise you because you're faithful and wonderful and glorious," and so on. But here, just that simple love that comes out every day is, "God, I love you with everything. Just tell me anything. I'll do anything. I love you that much." And the same then spills over to the wife. And to say to your wife daily, no matter how she thinks of herself, "I see nothing in you but perfection." That breaks her. And that is something tender, is how can you say that? Is because it's the truth. Because that's the way God sees us. And that's the way I don't see a flaw in you. I don't see, well, you know, I don't see that. I just see you're perfect. You couldn't be better. You're the best. And she delights in that. I just tell you, it makes you, you know, you feel like there's nothing I can do that he's going to notice. And I said, I'll never, ever, ever leave you or forsake you. Well, that's it, period. And I'm not interested in anybody else or anything else. I'm happy. I'm content. Why? Because you're a gift of God to me. And I know God has given me to you. And when you talk that way, then it changes the whole perception of what God is like, not what your husband's like. Because if God can't break a husband, he's not very powerful. But he has to be able to break that man until there's nothing left of him but love. And that's why we go through this furnace. That's why we go through, you know, believing in Jesus first and then going through your own cross and your own suffering and affliction and furnace and so on. So that then you can become a lover. Until you're dead, you're not going to love anyone else. Until you don't care about yourself because you know God takes care of you, you're not going to care. So to me, the atonement today, which we're talking about, Yom is, of course, the word for day. And Kippur is covering, or that which covers. Well, the fig leaves won't do it. So instead of being mad at them for wearing fig leaves, or, "Oh, thank God I'm not one of those," actually, it's our love to have God's heart for the afflicted, for the lost. And his heart is that all men would be saved. And we know it's not happening. And he's told us it won't happen. Nevertheless, that's his heart. And even if they perish and go to hell, he did pay for them and died for them, and truly his heart was for them. That Jesus can only come out when you're dead here. It doesn't come out even here. Here where you're being filled with the Spirit, that's every day. Being filled with the Spirit is not the same thing as being dead to this world and alive to God in Christ Jesus. That is the only thing that the world needs to see. So the picture that Mike, the only reason I come is because I want to hear over and over again that same truth, that there's a process here that God wants to send us through, and it's got endless permutations. It's got endless things. But I know the simplicity of it. I want to be in the outer court, and I want to go in the holy place until I'm dead, and then I want to live here forever and ever and ever and ever. So I think this is perfect teaching. Perfect teaching for me. So I am atoned. I'm at one with Christ.
Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Amen.
Amen.
Amen.